And I appreciate everybody. I know loves Robert and Charlotte. I tell you. Well,
yeah, we do. Yes, we do.
Hey, just a couple. Ever since I've come to Park West, I've always tried to listen to Charlotte. She's my favorite.
He tells it too, Charlotte.
Thank you so much. I am so excited about tonight.
Yes.
You know, you pray and you seek the Lord, and I can think of so many beautiful things in God's Word that I want to preach, but I really want the mind of the Lord, and I know I'm echoing. Is it something I'm doing wrong? Hello?
Hello.
But anyway, I hope you have your Bibles. If you do not, you probably have your phone or something that you can look at some passages. Yeah. But I've given out some notes. Does everybody have a copy of the notes that I brought? Yeah, that's better. Thank you so much. Anybody need them? Raise your hand. Do you need them? Okay, so it looks like we have them. I want to say, first of all, thank you, Emmett and Judy, for inviting us to come tonight. It's always a joy. You all are my family. I just love you so much. And I think about all the years that we've known each other, and what a privilege that it is. We are family. Can you imagine what heaven's going to be like?
Oh, yes.
Good glory. Will you all sit at my table?
Yes.
But I can think about heaven and how glorious it's going to be. No sickness, no disease, no dust, ladies.
No.
So anyway, I would like to ask all of you that are here that this Park West Church is not your church, will you raise your hand? Look at this.
That's good.
All right. Yes, we're glad you're here. Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Yes.
All right, well, I want you to go ahead, if you do have your Bibles, and we're going to turn to Mark, please, Mark chapter 10. And so you'll just be ready when we start, but I'm going to ask Leslie if she will come on up. She's, I think I shared with you all last time, we went to a church here in the city, and that's been several years ago. So I got to know Leslie there. Do you remember her doing the Villa De La Rosa?
Yes, we do.
Oh, my word. I love that song.
No,
but
yes.
I said, you just choose Leslie. Last time I said, you have to do Villa De La Rosa. But she's got something special that she feels that God has given to her. So I just want you to listen carefully to what God does through her.
Amen.
Don't be angry if I wash his feet with
my tears and dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love all around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. The way life used to be, I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. And I spent my days, poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I'd found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch. And now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. Praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil. No, you don't know the cost of the praise. You don't know the cost of the oil.
Thank you so much, Leslie. Yes. I really do appreciate it. Thank
you, Lord.
Glory to the name of Jesus. If you have your Bibles again, I want you to turn with me to Mark chapter 10. I'm sure that you will be familiar with this story, but I'm believing that you are going to hear things tonight possibly that you have not heard before. And I think you'll see how it ministers to each one of us. But in Mark chapter 10, and I tell you what I'm going to do is I'm going to read the whole story, and then we're going to come back and talk about these passages. Beginning in verse 46, and they came to Jericho, which is speaking of Jesus and the disciples. And as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he had heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace, but he cried the more a great deal. Thou son, Robert, this is playing up here, honey. It's, this at the very end. Yeah. Thank you, honey. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace, but he cried the more a great deal. Thou Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, Be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, What wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. All right, I want us to notice what's going on here in verse 46. It says, And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people. What you've got to realize in this story is Jesus realizes it's the time. It is his time to go into Jerusalem and be crucified. And this is what he was doing. But I want you to know, even with his face set to go to Jerusalem, the Lord Jesus has time for a blind man Amen. Who is begging.
Amen.
And I want you to know he has time for us. He yes. is not so busy mm-hmm. that he ignores you or doesn't see you. You are precious to him. Yes. You are valuable to
yes.
him.
Amen.
Now I want you to notice here, it said in the with the disciples and a great number of people. A lot of these people were probably going to the Passover, but a lot of these was following Jesus because of the miracles they had heard that he could do. So they want to see, you know, am I going to get to see a miracle? What is Jesus going to do? I want to make sure I'm here to see that. Now, I want you to know this blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. Now, a lot of people, again, are on this highway. If you can imagine with me, this wide road that was used, and people would walk up and down this highway to go to different places. And again, in this case, they were going to Jerusalem. Now, blind Bartimaeus, he was known by this name. You know, if you can imagine, it's one thing to have a handicap,
yeah.
but if that is put on your name, can you imagine how degrading that can be? Blind
yeah.
Bartimaeus.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because Bartimaeus actually means son of honor.
Man.
His name, though, was so opposite of who he really was. He was blind and he was begging. Mm-hmm. That doesn't sound like a son of honor.
Mm-hmm.
But I want you to know that's what his name meant. Notice he is sitting on the side of the highway. He's not on the highway. He's on the side. People are going and coming on the highway, but he is seated there next to the highway. Now you think, it's almost like people are going by. He can hear the voices.
Mm-hmm.
He knows they're going somewhere. But day after day, from morning to evening, probably not the Sabbath, but he would be placed there next to the highway, never really getting to go on, not able to go forward. And if he would arise, he could not see his way to get where he needed to be.
No.
So with that in mind, I want to look at 47. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Now if you can imagine with me,
Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy upon me.
Yes.
To the top of his voice, he was screaming, Jesus, Jesus, have mercy upon me.
Yes.
You think, well, why did he cry out to Jesus? He had heard about this man named Jesus. He had heard that he had opened the blinded eyes. He had heard that the dead would be raised to life.
Right.
And he knew that if Jesus would just ever come through town,
yes.
that he would be there and he could cry out for mercy.
Yes.
This was his chance
yes.
to have his eyes restored.
Amen. Amen.
So sure enough, he gets the word that Jesus is coming. And with that in mind, Son of David, which means he was crying out to the one he believed to be the Messiah.
Sure did.
This was the Messiah that they had heard prophesied. I'm sure the thoughts may have come to blind Bartimaeus. You know, Jesus again is leaving Jericho, and he doesn't have time for a blind man who begs. His thoughts were, I've got this small window of opportunity to get my eyes opened. Mm-hmm. So I must scream quickly and loudly.
Yes.
But would he listen to me? Would he hear me? And I'm just a beggar. There are so many people on that highway. He begins to think, I know he doesn't have time for me. And then he has healed others. But they must have been really holy people.
Yeah.
You know, the enemy can come against our minds and tell us what we're not.
That's right.
And that we're never going to get that miracle.
That's right.
Oh, God would do it for this one,
mm-hmm.
but God wouldn't do it for me.
Mm-hmm.
He's too busy for me, and I really don't matter.
Yeah.
That is a lie, and that's a lie from the pit of hell.
Yeah. Yeah.
Every one of us are precious in
yes.
His sight.
Yes.
Jesus didn't just die for a few of us, but He died for every
Amen.
One of us
Amen.
Because of His great love for you and me.
Yes.
We matter to the
yes.
Lord.
Amen.
In verse 48, and then He charged he and Bartimaeus that he should hold his peace. In other words, be quiet, Bartimaeus.
Yeah.
You know, were they ashamed of him? Were they embarrassed? This man that's so popular by the name of Jesus, why were they trying to keep him quiet? That he should hold his peace, but he cried the more a great deal. Thou son of David,
yes,
have mercy on me.
Amen.
And then Jesus, in there in verse 49, he stood still.
Yes.
When you cry out unto the Lord, He doesn't keep marching.
No, we don't.
When you cry out unto Him in faith, I want you to know He stops right where He is.
Exactly. Yes.
And He listens to our cry.
Yes.
Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, Be of good comfort. Rise, he calleth thee. You know, people may discourage us. You have to be careful what you share with other people. The Bible talks about not throwing your pearls before the swine. Or the swine can turn and tear you with it. Do you hear me? So when you share, you make sure that you're led by the Holy Spirit. People can discourage you from laying hold of what God is saying and what He's dealing with your heart about. So people may try to discourage us, but notice in that 49, Jesus again stops. He stands still and He listens to the cry of blind Bartimaeus. I was thinking of the passage in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 24, probably one of my favorite verses. And it says, Faithful is He that calleth you, who also will do it. Now it's interesting because Jesus calls for blind Bartimaeus. He calls for him to come. Notice that scripture says, Faithful is he who calls you,
mm-hmm.
who will also do it.
Mm-hmm.
He will do what he calls you to do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, wait a minute, Jesus. How is that possible? Blind Bartimaeus could say, How in the world could I ever come to you? I can't see.
Mm-hmm.
He could have remained on the side of the highway.
Yes.
But I want you to know when they call for him, Bartimaeus didn't stay there in his condition. He made a decision. If he's called me, I can get up and I can go to Jesus.
Amen.
So we think about that. He hearkened to the cry. He is calling us. When we get off the side of the highway and move towards Jesus, what is holding us back? Why do we remain on the side? Why aren't we going forward? Many of you are going forward, but sometimes there's fear that tries to hold us on the sidelines.
Yeah.
Sometimes we're worried or we're filled with anxiety.
Yeah.
Some are sick and some are depressed. Or I'm too old or I'm too young. I'm poor. I'm not holy enough. I never add up. So when we have these mindsets, we remain on the side of the highway.
Yeah. Amen.
When God, our Lord Jesus Christ, is saying, arise up
mm-hmm.
and come.
Yeah.
Come just as you are. Don't wait till you're fixed before you get up and move toward Jesus.
Right.
Here was a man who was blind, but yet he was able to get up from that place and move toward Jesus.
Amen.
He couldn't see. But he could hear where his voice was coming from. And I can see him making his way to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You know, there are things sometimes that will try to hinder us and keep us on the side of the highway. And sometimes it's because the enemy, the devil, wants us to be reminded of our past. You did this. You did that. This is the reason you're going through this. It's because of your past. Well, let me tell you, brother and sisters, if you've been born again, your sin has been removed as far as the east is from the west.
Hallelujah.
And I'm so glad we serve a mighty God who does not remember our sin anymore.
Amen.
And you know, the devil wants to bring condemnation, he wants to bring guilt, and he wants to bring shame. But let me tell you, the devil is a defeated foe. He has no authority over you and me in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I'm thinking of a passage that also I love, and that's Romans 8 and verse 1, when it says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit."
Amen.
You see, if condemnation comes, it's coming from an individual. You're condemning yourself, or you're hearing the lie of the devil. God does not condemn you. Now, I'll tell you what I am grateful for. It's when I mess up, when I say something I shouldn't. The Bible says my heart condemns me.
Yeah, right.
And I'm glad it does. I'm glad that God can stay with me and hold me. Because when I mess up, I know I'm miserable. I am miserable on the inside. But then I'm quick to say, Jesus, I call that sin.
Yes.
And I ask you to forgive me and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness.
Amen.
Now, if you will, look at verse 50. And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus. Now, I want you to imagine when he got the word that Jesus said, come. Here's what we want to imagine. You see, there was a garment that was issued from the government. It was for those who were blind, those that were handicapped. And they would put that garment on. Why? So they would have the legal right to sit next to the highway and beg. But when Jesus called him, he did not leave on the garment. He heard Jesus calling to come.
Yes.
And when he started trying to get up, he let the garment be cast away to the side.
Yes.
He refused to be identified with the blind. He knew that Jesus had something in store for him. You may be dealing with things and you may be facing things, but let me tell you, it is time to cast it to the side. It's time to come to Jesus and let him minister to you in what you have need for. He's calling us, and he is faithful who calls each one of us. And as we rise up and we go forward, I want you to know we'll get just what we need to do what he has called us to do. Nothing is going to hinder us. Nothing is going to stop us. Blind Bartimaeus did not wait till his eyes were opened before he chose to throw aside the garment that said he was blind. He refused to say, I'm going to sit here on the side of the highway. I'm getting up. My Lord has called me. And I'm going forward.
Right.
Don't you wait till you get everything just right before you head off to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I want you to know he's there. And he wants you to come just the way you are.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I may tell my age, but I used to love the song, Just As I Am.
Amen.
I come. I'm not going to wait till I get it all together. But I'm coming to you, Jesus. And that's what he wants. You don't wait till it all happens. You don't wait till it's all right. You get up. You go forward.
Glory.
Jesus is there waiting on you. Hallelujah. Worship. Yes, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. We give you praise.
Hallelujah.
We give you glory.
Yes.
What is our identity? Are we quick to say, I'm a child of the King?
Yes, I am.
I'm more than a conqueror. I have the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Or are we paralyzed, if you will, beside the highway with shame and guilt, low self-esteem? I'm not smart enough. I'm weak. I'm sick. I'm less than. I'm a failure. I want you to know, no matter if these things are trying to plague you, we serve the great I am. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So don't allow these kinds of things to hold you in bondage. And let me say this. Most of you know I counsel here at the church, mm-hmm. but so many people are coping with emotions and feelings.
Yes, they are.
They're just coping.
It's all they're doing.
You know, people get busy doing all kinds of things. We can even get busy with a Christian television program or Christian music, but we never deal with the issues of the past. You see, the scripture says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed or made whole. That can be faults that I have committed. But let me tell you, I've asked Jesus to forgive me, and he forgave me.
Yes.
And he's washed me of that. And the same thing with you. But sometimes there comes a place that I need to sit down with somebody I can trust, whether it's your leadership, whether it's a Christian spirit-filled friend. And a lot of people will come to me for counseling, but they will begin to say, this happened to me. Let me give you an example. I had a lady, she was in her later 70s. And she came in and she sat down on the chair and she began to weep. And she could hardly speak. And I said, honey, tell me. It's all right, but just tell me what's going on. It's confidential. It doesn't go outside this room. And she said, I was a very young girl. And she said, this young man, he grabbed me and he raped me. Said that happened and it was like 60 years ago. She said, I have lived with the shame and the guilt of that my whole life. And she wept uncontrollably. And she said, I can't do it anymore. And I want you to know, I shared the scripture with her. I said, somebody did you a terrible fault. Confess your faults.
One to another. Yes.
And what the Lord did, he said, and I will heal, I will make whole.
Yes, he will.
I held that lady in my arms while she buried her little face in my shoulder, and she wept, and she wept, and she wept. And I broke the power of shame and guilt and darkness off of her mind and off of her body.
Yes.
And I said, I call you free in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And she threw her little arms up.
Hallelujah.
Let me tell you, don't wait about those kinds of things. You think, well, I'll just suppress them and I'll keep going forward. Or I'm too embarrassed and I'm too ashamed. I can't tell anybody that. Let me tell you something. You have to tell somebody. We're called to bear one another's burdens, and we all need each other.
Amen.
We've all had things that have hurt us and wounded us. But I want you to know we serve a mighty God who will bring the healing that we have need of so that we can arise and we can move forward in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou I should do unto thee? Now, Jesus, you saw this blind Bartimaeus trying to get to you, and he's groping around. What do you mean? What does he want? Let me tell you, even though Jesus knew, I want you to know it is vital that we decree to the Lord what we have need of. He is waiting for you to specifically ask him, and he will minister to you again right where you are. Notice again, Jesus answered and said, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, which is my master, Rabboni. It was his personal faith in Jesus Christ. He said that I might receive my sight. And then verse 52, and Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy faith have made thee whole. Now, this here where it says, go thy way, he was saying to Bartimaeus, depart. Not that he was going to make his own way through life. That's not what he's saying. But you have come to me. You have made your request known. Now go your way. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Now I'm going to look at that in just a moment. But notice this part, and immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, notice this part, in the way.
In the way.
What is that talking about? Mm-hmm. He followed Jesus in the highway.
Yep.
He had been beside the highway. He had been seated there, defeated, begging, and it looked like no hope for this man.
Yep.
But when he came to Jesus, his eyes were open.
Right.
He didn't sit there and wait till his eyes were open. He stood up when he was still blind and made his way to Jesus and followed Jesus in the highway. Where before he could hear the crowds going up and down the highway while he sit there hour after hour after hour beside the highway.
Yes.
Are we still seated on the side of a highway?
No.
Are we crying out, begging, oh God, please do this. God, please do that.
No.
You that are moms, when you were in the kitchen and that little son or that little daughter came in and said, Mommy, I'm so hungry. I'm really, really hungry. Well, you know, we're not just going to turn our backs on them. When they look up and say, Mommy or Daddy, I'm hungry, what do? We'll lay down everything we've got to get over there. And you know what we might say? Now, what do you want? Now, it won't be too long to supper. You can have sugar or sweets, but I can get you a banana, right? What do you want, in other words? Well, the Lord Jesus cares, and he begins to say, what is it that you need? What do you want? Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. When I looked at that, I thought of the power to heal, obviously. Of course, we know it comes from Jesus. But it was Bartimaeus who would not stop crying out to Jesus. It was Bartimaeus that believed Jesus to heal him. How does faith come? The Bible tells us that it comes by hearing, Romans 10:17. And it comes by hearing by the Word of God. So, you know, we want to hear as much word as we can. And this is the reason the faith had grown in blind Bartimaeus. He had heard the people talking about Jesus. And he knew that if he'd just come through, that he would receive his miracle. But you know, Jesus, even though he said this, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And then he said, thy faith hath made thee whole. Satan listened to that, and he was thinking, okay, now if the Word of God comes forth and we hear it over and over, a man hears it over and over again, faith will arise in his heart to lay hold of the promise. So if that's how it works, then I could do the same thing. I could come along to individuals, and I could begin to declare what I want them to believe. You know, it's going to be something that is going to cause a defeat mentality. It's going to cause something to where they feel depressed and oppressed. I can get them, the devil said, to believe me. So that's what the devil comes along. You see, some of you are hearing things in your mind and you think it's you. And you know, we don't lie to ourselves, do we? That would be foolish. If I say something to me, it's because that's what I believe. But the enemy knows exactly how to mimic your voice. He knows how to say something to you that is going to try to discourage you, to distract you from believing the promises of God. So the devil wants to speak to us over and over and over, trying to get us to listen to him. But you know, in 1 John 3:8 says, for this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil.
Yeah.
Well, if that's the reason, one reason he manifested, let me tell you, he destroyed the works of the devil. He didn't have to do it.
Yeah.
He destroyed the works of the devil.
Amen.
Our believing the lies of Satan empowers him to move in against us. We must believe the promises of God and declare them over and over in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You know, when you've got a need, there's something that you're wanting from the Lord, you know, you'll take that scripture that promises that and you'll begin to speak it over and over and over. How many times have I walked into my prayer closet and that there would be something that I had need of, and I would look at the scriptures concerning that. One of my favorites is John 16:23, when Jesus said, "In that day, you shall ask me nothing, but anything you ask the Father in my name, he will give it you." So how many times I've asked the Father in Jesus' name for certain things, and the devil the whole time is telling me why it's not going to work. I don't mind giving an example. My oldest son needed braces on his teeth. And in the natural, we didn't have the finances to take him and put braces on those teeth. So I said, "God, I'm believing you. You know, I'm looking to you. I'm not looking at what we have or what we don't have. I'm looking to you." And I started making my petition known, "Father, in Jesus' name." And I take my Bible up and I point at John 16:23. "Look here, Father, what your son Jesus said. You know, he's my Lord and he's my Savior. And he's not a man that he should lie. And this is what he said, Father. He said you would do it if I would ask in Jesus' name." So, Lord, I thank you that you are providing braces for my son's teeth in Jesus' name. Amen. Daily I would go into that den area and I would read the word. I would declare the word. I would declare the word. And one day it was like I swallowed a basketball. I knew that I knew in my knower, I knew that it was done. It was mine and I would not be denied. Well, I took off running just all over the place. Why? Because I knew I had it. There was a confidence that came. And sometimes it doesn't happen in a moment. It was day after day. I got on the phone and made an appointment with the orthodontist. Robert said, "You did what?" We took him in there. He checked out his teeth and he gave us this big amount of money. And I looked at him and I said, "Sir, we can't do that." And he said, "Well, okay, let's look at this again," and blah, blah, blah. "Could you do this?" He came down quite a bit, and I said, "Sir, we can't do that." And he grinned. I think he's getting embarrassed for us. But he just kept looking down, and he said, "Well, we could do this, and you all could pay this much a month." Well, I about fell out of my chair, and I looked at Robert. He said, "We could do that." You see, when you know in your knower,
you know,
there is nothing impossible with God.
That's right.
You hold fast to what he says. And when the enemy tells you you can't have it, there's no way, there's no hope, wake up. What are you thinking? Well, let me tell you, remember, he is a liar.
That's right.
And he may be using his voice to sound just like my voice, but I can judge it. Why? Because I know the word of God. And the enemy is trying to oppose what God's word says. I refuse to be denied. And I told God, "You may not like it, but God, I'm not letting you go. I'm going to hold fast to you and I'll hold fast to my last breath because your word is true. God, do you hear me? I'm not letting you go in Jesus' name." God loves it. He just beams all over when you have that attitude. "Oh, he or she's not going to let me go till they get it." Well, I love it. The Bible said, put God in remembrance of his word. It's not that he forgot it. He just loves to hear you say
Amen.
It. He loves to hear
Amen.
His word. Yes. Notice again, "Go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole."
Yep.
Now, we saw that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We see there is a real devil that wants to oppose that. So he begins to decree what he wants us to have. But again, he is trying to distract you. It is amazing how much in counseling that I hear people that are seeing demonic spirits. They're very real. If you want any more information on that, I can share. In fact, that's the book I've been writing on now for years. We're talking about the authority of the believer over demonic spirits. But I want you to know the only really strong power that Satan has is deception. He wants to get you to believe a lie. And we'll say it again. But your believing empowers the works of darkness. You've got to make sure your believing is right. You've got to be believing in what God's word says. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 through 5. "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." We're not warring against men and women. We're not warring in our flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. You see, our weapons is not knives and guns and swords and arrow, bow and arrow. That is not the kind of weapons that we're talking about.
Right.
But we do have weapons, and they are mighty
yes.
to the pulling down of strongholds.
Yes.
Strongholds, you could probably do a lot of teaching on that, but I am wanting you to focus on the stronghold of wrong believing. I'm not going to get in a lot of my testimony, but many of you are familiar that when I was hearing the voice say, Charlotte, you're going to die. You're going to die. Every day, all day long sometimes, I would hear, you're going to die. You're going to die. Well, you know, I began to believe it.
Yep.
I began to believe I was going to die. I started planning for my death.
Yes.
I was praying for my children because, you know, I thought about leaving my children and them not having their mom. But I want you to know, I was at the time pregnant with Shantae. And I believed it so much that right after she was born, I died. I'm making this short. And I came out of my body. I wasn't in my body anymore.
Yeah.
But thank God that happened in Mother's home when she
yes.
started a prayer meeting
yes.
for me.
Yes.
I'm watching them carry my body into the house. And when they step in, all at once I could feel my spirit come back into my body. And I'm hearing people say, no, devil, you spirit of death, you will not have her in the name of Jesus. And I began to weep. I was weeping. Why? Because I knew that the voice was not the voice of God preparing
yes.
me for death.
Yes.
It was a devil
yes.
that was assigned against me.
Yes.
And every day, every moment,
yes.
he
yes.
was tormenting me with
yes.
the thought, you shall die.
Yes.
You see, some of you are being tormented by the words of demonic spirits. And they're speaking to you over and over. And it causes you to feel depressed and oppressed. And fearful and worried. But let me tell you, after I got back in my body and I realized that it was the devil that had lied to me, I tell you what, he doesn't do that to me
Glory.
Anymore
yes.
because I know the truth
yes.
and the truth made
yes.
me free.
Yes.
The truth made
yes.
me free.
Yes.
You see, you've got to find what the Word of God says and you've got to oppose what the devil
yes.
is
exactly
saying
right.
at you. He wants to distract you.
Right.
He wants you to believe a lie so that he can take you out before you're supposed to go
exactly.
to be with the Lord. He promised
yes.
to satisfy you with long life. And each one of us is very important in the kingdom of God.
Try.
You know, I read back about a lot of the revivals, and you've read a lot of them too. How many times, though, did you see the older generation came together
yes.
and believed God
yes.
for a move
yes.
of the Spirit?
Yes.
Believed God
yes.
to open the blind
yes.
eyes and cause the deaf to hear
yes.
and the dumb to speak.
Yes.
And to leap as the heart.
Yes.
You see, they birthed it in prayer.
Right.
Every one of us are children of God.
Yes.
And we have the authority and the privilege of prayer.
Amen.
I want to encourage you. I'm not saying you have to come here to church for a prayer meeting. We would love to have you. But let me tell you, we are birthing something in the realm of
yes.
the Spirit.
Yes.
And we're beginning to see it flow over
yes.
into the natural.
Yes.
Church, let me tell you, there's a last day revival coming.
Right.
There's a last move of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And let me tell you, when it moves, you're going to see multitudes flow into Zion. I decree that we're going to see those that have blinded eyes, but we're going to see them open. We're going to see the miraculous.
Yes.
And then I believe with all of my heart that Jesus is going to split those eastern skies. He's going to come and take us home. It's a coming, brothers and sisters. So I want to encourage you, pray and believe, because our prayers is what's going to birth the will of God into the earth.
Yes.
We must pray.
Yes.
We must believe the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. The devil tells you, for example, I'm going to give you an example. The devil tells us, well, your son or your daughter will never be saved. He tells you they're going to hell. I've seen people worried about their children or their grandchildren, and they're sitting on the side of the highway, if you will. They're wanting to hear that child or that grandchild has been born again. And of course, we all have family, somebody that we want to see saved. But you see, you can't sit down on the sideway or next to the highway and just wait. You've got to get out there on the highway and keep following Jesus.
Right.
If you sow even into somebody else's life, you've got a harvest that's coming to you.
That's right.
You know, when you raise them in the way they should go, train them in the way they should go, they will not depart
they
when
won't.
They're old.
Right.
And even if you didn't, you can have the desires of your heart
Amen.
When they're in line
Amen.
With God's will. And I can assure you, it's His will for all. To be saved.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So we have to get up and we have to keep moving forward and believe in God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, the devil is a liar.
Always.
Now, he just came to you and he said, they're not going to be saved. They're going to go to hell. You might as well just face the fact. When you go to heaven, your son, your daughter, your grandchild won't be there because they're in hell. And you know, that can be tormenting.
It is.
That can just really weigh on your mind and weigh on your heart. But when you know the promises of God's word and the devil starts lying to you, I know what it is to lay in bed and it was like a huge screen and I could see one of my children and I could see them in a casket laying there. And I tell you, it would try to tear me up so badly and I would jump up and I would start praying and interceding again. I don't know how much fasting that I did, but I want you to know I knew I was not going to allow the devil to have one of my kids.
No.
As long as there's breath in my lungs, I'm going to keep warring for that child in Jesus' name. But you see, the devil was trying to distract me. Seemed like the more I prayed, the worse things got.
Yeah.
Don't think that a strange thing.
Yeah.
Because when you start declaring the word of God and praying, the devil can't stand it.
Yeah.
He is so afraid that you're going to get the answer to that prayer.
Right.
And he tries to come against you with his lies.
Right.
But you know, one of the promises that I held fast to, and I hope it's there in your notes, I believe it is. But it's what helped me so much, and that's Jeremiah 31, 17 and 18. And it says, thus saith the Lord, refrain thy voice from weeping and thine eyes from tears. For thy work, your intercession, your declaring the word, your doing spiritual warfare shall be rewarded, saith the Lord. And they, your children, shall come again from the land of the enemy. And there is hope in thine end, saith the Lord, that thy children shall come again to their own borders. Hallelujah to the Lamb. That's what God said. And He is not a liar. And He is no respecter of persons. Don't you let go of that one that you are believing God for. We're done.
Right.
Amen,
right.
Daughter.
Woo!
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Her daughter was just born again.
Woo!
She would not let God go.
Right.
And I want you to know she came back to their own border. Hallelujah.
Yes.
To the land.
Yes.
And God will do that for every one of you. If I die in faith, I am not going to let go of God.
Never.
Just as sure as I was believing, even after I'm out of here, you know, and that's what I said about the revival. I decree I'm going to be here and I'm going to see it. But I'm going to, if I go check out of here before that day, I know revival
that's
is coming.
Right.
I will not be denied of that last day revival.
Right.
There's a former rain and there's a latter rain. It's a coming
Amen.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name. And then we see in Isaiah 55:11, the Amplified Bible says it this way. God says, so will my word be, which goes out of my mouth. It will not return to me void, useless or without result. Without accomplishing what I desire, God says, and without succeeding in the matter for which I sinned.
Amen.
Now, I want you to notice this part. God says, so will my word be, which goes out of my mouth. It will not return unto me void. I want you to notice the word of God has got to be returned to God.
Yep.
Now, listen very carefully. So when you have promises, it's good to look at them. It's good to meditate them. But when you begin to declare the word of God, the promises of God over your situation, I want you to know God says it's not going to return into me void, but it's going to accomplish that that I have decreed and declared for you.
Yes.
You've got the promise. If you will speak the word,
Amen.
It's going to come to pass
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
God will see to it.
Amen.
Amen.
But we must, in our prayer closet, get your promises.
Yes.
Speak them out loud to God. Let them return unto Him in praise and in worship.
Yes.
Keep saying what God says about you.
Amen.
Again, Ephesians 6:12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in high places.
Yes.
There are different levels of demonic spirits, but they're all of darkness.
That's right.
And you have authority, and you have been called to do warfare with demonic spirits.
Amen.
You have authority as you speak the word of God. It's the sword of the Spirit.
That's right.
It's called a double edge, which means two mouths.
That's right.
God spoke it, but you and I need to speak it the second time.
Okay.
Then it becomes that two-edged sword. Notice, it's the Spirit. It is the weapon of the Holy Spirit. He inside of you, when you begin to speak that word, the Holy Ghost takes that sword and he comes against what the enemy's trying to do. But you sit still. Well, that's just not my nature, Sister Charlotte. I'm just not real outward going. Stop it. If you're really serious about that thing you're believing God for, then you're going to open your mouth and you're going to declare the word of God.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. We wrestle just like Jesus did. When did he wrestle in the Mount of Temptation when he said, "It is written"? We speak the word that combats the lies of the devil. We resist him in the power of the name of Jesus. Again, some of you have heard me say this. I know God has opened my eyes on three different occasions that I could see in the realm of the Spirit. And when I would see the demonic spirits that were there, and they were all different, when I said, in the name of Jesus, I want you to know those things curl up, they cringe, and they look back because they don't want to leave, they don't want to walk away from you. But if you're a child of the living God, you've been given the name that's above every name, and you have authority to cast them out in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
How about the word diabolus? Have you ever heard that term before? Satan attempts to bounce like a ball against our minds. He comes over and over until he penetrates our thinking. You see, to begin with, when the devil starts his thing, you might hear him say, "You're not smart enough. You are a failure. Look at your past. Your children are going to hell. You don't have enough money. There's no hope for you. Just sit down on the side of the highway and give up." He bounces against our minds over and over and over. But as children of God, we have the authority to speak the word of God over and over and over. And he's going to take his attacks and he's going to run from you with it. But you cannot sit down and do nothing.
That's right.
I have a man that came to me. He said, "Charlotte," he said, "there's this thing. It's dark and it has this hood thing over it. And it's black. And it comes in and it looks at me. And it sits down across from me in my room and stares at me." He said, "Now you're not going to report me, are you?" And I said, "Sir, if I have to report you, I'll have to report a lot of us." But you see, he didn't feel the liberty to share because they thought he would have, they put him away.
Yes, he was crazy.
And he said, "This is happening to me every day. This thing comes and he sits across and he mocks me and he looks at me and he laughs at me." And he said, "I don't know what to do." A child of God did not know what to do.
Oh,
it breaks my heart.
Yes.
People, you don't have to put up with the devil.
No, you don't.
He is a liar.
Yes.
And he's the father of lies.
Yes.
And he's been defeated.
Yes.
And I've got good news for you. One of these days, he will be thrown into the lake of fire for all eternity.
Yes.
But until then, church, arise up and go forward.
Amen.
Don't you sit down. Don't you give up. And don't you quit. The word of God is truth, and our Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We have to decree, it is written. We speak that word, and then we see what we can sound like our voice. I talked about that. But here's five things I want you to notice here. It's in your notes. It is important to know the word so that we know when the devil is speaking. You see, when I was hearing that voice, you're going to die. You're going to die. You see, I didn't know the promise. It said God would satisfy us with long life.
Amen.
You know, the Bible says, God speaking, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. And so many of God's children, I believe, can die prematurely because they do not know the truths of God's word. I didn't know, and it literally almost cost me my life. It was the mercies of God that God raised up a group of people to war on my behalf. And when once I had my mind renewed to the word of God that has promised to satisfy me with long life, when the enemy would come back, and he did, he came back I don't know how many times, and he still tries to come back and bring fear to me. But you know, I love the scriptures, 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. For God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. Secondly, we must cast down what the devil is saying and declare the word. So when the enemy comes to me, and he does, it's just crazy. I can be minding my own business, and he would say something horrible to me, something that would try to bring fear. And out loud, here's what you do. You foul devil of hell, you just said, I cast that down. I render it powerless and of none effect in the name of Jesus. For it is written. And when you speak that word, I want you to know he has to flee in Jesus' name. We need to be submitted to God and resist the devil in Jesus' name. And I want you to know that devil will flee. He will run from you in terror.
Yes,
but we must resist him. Well, does he know what I'm thinking? The only way he knows what you're thinking is if you're having a conversation or if he's just said something to you, he knows what you're thinking. But let me tell you, if you're just doing your own thing, he don't know what's going through your mind. He doesn't have a clue. But we got to resist him. Look at the fourth one, Matthew 18:18. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind or forbid on earth, forbid on the earth, shall be bound or forbidden in heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose or allow on earth shall be loosed or allowed in heaven. I am not going to allow the devil to come against me in my household. Does he try? Yes. Does he try to come with oppression sometimes? Yes, he does. I can hear some pretty tough things. Does he try to bring depression sometimes? Yes, he does. Does he try to bring anxiety my way? Yes, he does. But let me tell you, I am not going to sit down on the side of the highway and beg. I have a God who is ready to answer my prayer. I have a God who's ready to move on my behalf. And you have that kind of God too. He loves you and he cares for you. But we are not, here's my words, I am not aiming, devil, to let you do this in Jesus' name. And I address him, demanding him to go in Jesus' name. And then we have the power of heaven to back us when we will speak.
Yes.
Before I read the last one, I know that this is what I had really prayed about bringing to you. But I think a lot of God's children are waiting on God to do something. When if God wanted to do that, Sister Charlotte, he would do that. That is not true. It is not God's will that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. If God's going to do it anyway, then why do we have missionaries? Why do we pray for them? You know, a lot of people are just waiting on God when God said, I gave the earth to Adam and Eve. They were to guard the garden. They were to keep out intruders. Right there was a big hint that the devil was around somewhere. He gave them the authority in the earth. Church, Jesus has bought back what Adam and Eve sold. We have authority in the earth. If you're waiting on God, you may be backing up. God has given you the promises, and we need to be speaking them. We need to be taking authority, and we need to speak over our homes, our properties, our family in the name of Jesus. Your words have power and authority. Let us speak life. Let's don't speak death and decree and declare what you know in your heart God wants you to have.
Amen.
Ooh, I could shout it.
Hallelujah.
Do we believe the words of Jesus?
Amen.
Yes, I do.
Luke 10:19, behold, I give unto you power or authority to tread or to walk upon serpents and scorpions and over a little bit of the power of the enemy.
No.
All the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you.
Nothing.
Church, the authority is just not given to our leadership.
That's right.
The authority is given to you.
Yes.
Mark 16, cast out the devil where you find him.
Yes.
When he comes roaring like a lion at you, you resist him.
Amen.
You have the authority.
Yes.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Father, I have spoken your word. I thank you and I praise you, Lord God, in heaven for ministering through me, Lord. And I decree that no devil will steal the word of God that's been preached in the name of Jesus. Lord, I have spoken the word to your children and I have spoken the word back to you. Now, Lord, I thank you, Father, for bringing it to pass. For you promised that you confirm the word with signs and wonders following in the mighty name of Jesus. And Father God, we thank you and we praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Robert, if you want to play that music real soft, this is what I want you to do. If you have a coat or a jacket, or if you don't have something like that, you're welcome to take this blanket. I want you to see the kinds of things that try to make you or lead you or distract you to sit down on the side of the highway. We all deal with something. No one's exempt. But anything that tries to weigh on you, if it's guilt, again, shame, condemnation, if it's your family, if it's your finances, if it's your health, whatever that is, we need to cast that off of us.
Amen.
And we need to arise and to go forth on the highway.
Yes.
You see, that's actually what highway means. It means to go forth. It means to travel upon. So we do not want to be caught sitting down. We want to go forward.
Amen.
People, Jesus is coming soon.
Yes.
Amen.
And we need to cast off those things that try to hinder
Amen.
Us. Amen?
Amen.
So if you'll stand up, and we're going to do this together. Whatever this is that what the enemy wants you to identify with, defeat, doubt, lack, sickness, hopelessness, worry, anxiety. Is it because of our finances that we feel like we have to sit down on the side of the highway? What is it that you identify with? Are you identifying with who Jesus says that you are? Do we identify that we're more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us? If you have something around your shoulder, I want you to think, what is this? This garment that I'm wearing around me, I want you to identify it. You have to whisper it to yourself. We do not want to be identified with Satan's lies. We want to be identified that we are children of the Most High God. So right now, Jesus says, I'm calling you. I'm calling you. Come to me. You don't have to wait till everything is right. Just come to Jesus. And as we come to him, we're going to throw away. Now right now, if you'll just let that fall in your seat, that is on you, let it, cast it away, let it fall. Now we're going to arise. We're going to go to Jesus right now. Every eye closed. He's right there waiting. He's waiting for you to come. You are free from the identity that the enemy has tried to give to you. That is not going to paralyze us. We cast away those things that would hinder us. Jesus is there. He calleth you. He gives to you what you have need of, for He is faithful, who calls you, who will also do it. And Father, right now, by your Holy Spirit, touch bodies right now. Touch bodies right now, Lord, and minister healing. Father, where there's lack, I ask you for provision, for you are Jehovah Jireh. God, I agree with my brothers and sisters for the salvation of their children and their grandchildren. Those that are bound by drugs and alcohol, we break its authority over them in the name of Jesus. I want you to begin speaking out loud what you believe, not what the enemy's portraying to you. Speak what you believe in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord God in heaven, that our children and our grandchildren are coming back to their own borders. They will not perish in their sin, but they are coming back to the things of God in the name of Jesus. We decree the word of the Lord that I may feel weak, but let the weak say, I am strong. I thank you, Lord, for strength to do what you called us to do in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God, when there is hurt and there is division in our families or other individuals, then Lord God in heaven, that there would be restoration in those areas. Oh God in heaven, if we need to say forgive me, then Lord, we will be bold to ask for forgiveness in the name of Jesus. Lord, now we thank you that as we come to you, you are here to minister in the name of Jesus. Now if you can lift your hands and thank him. Thank him for getting you back on the highway, that you're going forward. You have arisen from that place and you're going forward with Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, you may have come tonight and you know that your life is not where it needs to be with Jesus Christ. You're seated next to the highway as well. There's all this guilt in your heart, and how could God do this for me and do that for me when I have messed up so bad? I want you to know there is nothing too hard for God. He is love. He is the lover of your soul. You know, even Saul, later known as Paul, the Bible says that he called himself the chiefest of sinners. He held the coats of those that stoned Stephen to death. But you know, I want you to look how he got on the highway. He arose up and he moved forward. Why? Because he cried out, Lord, Lord. And we see how God used him so mightily.
Yes.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for being here. Thank you for ministering to every individual. God, I believe in that no one will leave this place if they have not made their lives right with you, Jesus. God in heaven, I thank you for the word that you brought forth, Father. And God in heaven, it will not return void, because we're going to return it unto you with thanksgiving and with praise in the name of the Lord Jesus. And everybody said,
Amen.
I will be here as long as I need to be. If you want special prayer, if you want us to lay hands on you and pray, we will do that. But you've got your outline. Meditate those promises that are there. And again, thank you for having me. And I just love you so much.